Welcome to Breadboarding. In this video, we'll be summarizing the first 10 Breadboard Video Controller videos in the Breadboard Video Controller playlist for the Nanocomp 6809. So in this video, in 15 minutes, we're going to go through the design build of the video controller and then show how it can run Tetris. Here's Tetris from a later stage of the project. The Nanocomp is based on a project which was first published in January 1981 Wireless World magazine, which used a Motorola 6802 microprocessor. There was then a later update to the project in July 1981, which was using the Motorola 6809 microprocessor, which in my opinion was probably the best 8-bit micro of the time. This block diagram shows the end state of the main Nanocomp project after probably about 18 or 19 videos. And it's true to the original design, with the exception of we've added some buffers to allow the computer to be extended to cover video controllers and other functions. And the address decode has been replaced by a more flexible programmable logic device. And we also added a serial port with a USB PC link so we could download software. This was an early version of the Nanocomp, which is very much like the original with the exception of the extra serial port here. And here's a later version of the Nanocomp where we've added the buffer chips here and we've replaced the original address decoder with a programmable logic device here. These leads here are from the logic analyzer, which you sometimes use for diagnosing issues with the project. So why build a breadboard video controller? Well, initially to understand how video controllers work, prove breadboards can work at higher frequencies above 10 megahertz, primarily using 1980s and possibly 1990s hardware, but not using anything like a Raspberry Pi or a field program or gate array, try and make the best video controller for the 6809, and really to recreate the Dragon 32 computer, which is like the Tandy color computer as I would have liked it. It's going to be VGA compatible output, and we'll be using a Motorola 6845 compatible cathode ray tube controller chip. In fact, we'll be using a Hitachi one. It uses dual port video RAM. So this is RAM that actually has two lots of address lines and two lots of data lines. That simplifies the layout of the early stages of the video card. We'll be using a VGA standard 25.175 MHz dot clock with a fairly simple digital analog converter using a resistor array. We'll be using the characters will be defined in RAM, which we'll download from the PC over the serial port initially. This will produce in VGA-like but not PC compatible output. So this card couldn't be plugged into a PC and used like a normal VGA card. We'll be building this incrementally, building a step at a time, and in later steps we'll be replacing the dual port video RAM with single port faster 64K RAM, which will complicate the design a bit. So here's the original plan. So we're covering here steps 1 to 5, and we're going to be going through the build sequences very fast and doing limited amounts of discussion about the design. If you want to know more details about that, please look at the Breadboard Video Controller playlist, which will take you through each video one at a time. So I use the Motorola 6845. This chip was used on the Commodore PET, the BBC Micro, and on the IBM Color Graphics Array adapter. It's flexible and not as constrained as some other chips like the 6847 that was used in the Dragon 32. It can address up to 16,000 characters, and with 32 rows per character, it can also address up to 512K of RAM. It's designed for characters but can be used for graphics, and it can work at the frequencies you need to do VGA output. So here's the diagram that has come from later stages of the project, but you're going to use this for the early phases just to cover the first stages in the project. So there are a few areas here where individual logic chips have been replaced with a one program or logic device. So we'll be using the individual logic chips in this first stage here, but they'll be replaced in a later phase of the project. So what we'll be doing here is we'll be wiring up the cathode ray tube controller, getting a clock signal for it. So the 25 megahertz clock gets divided by 8 to provide the character clock. We'll then be designing the digital analog converter and a buffer chip that controls whether or not we show the foreground or background colors. And what this should allow us to do is to output a VGA signal with different color blocks and regions on the screen. So we'll plug in the oscillator and the CRTC, check the frequency on the scope. We've got the counter chips there, dividing by 8 to get the character clock, plugging in the data lines and control pins. And this is the buffer and the digital analog converter. We're then just going to test this on solid colors for the different combinations of colors. And then we're plugging in the red, green, blue intensity lines into different address lines. So we get these different bars, and this is on the video capture card. So it all looks pretty good. So what we've done now is we've got the digital analog converter outputting the different color signals, and we've got the synchronization signals allowing us to get a steady display. What we're going to do now is add the character support. So the character generator RAM will output the raster image of the selected character line by line based on the row from the CRTC. And this then goes to a shift register, which is clocked by our 25 megahertz dot clock. Each line of characters is latched using the character latch. So what we're going to do is to set this up, and we will, to start with, just hook the character generator into the CRTC address line. So we'll just see the first 255 characters, and then it will just repeat each time. So it gives us a test pattern. So we need some VGA fonts from this side. We're using the 8-bit wide by 16 high ones. We could also use CGA ones. We then need to convert it into an S record format so we can load it into memory starting at C000. This is the S record format of the font. And then what we can do is to use Nanocomp load to load this into RAM. This is the video chip with the left and right address and data signals and the other chips we'll be using. So just plugging in the RAM there and the shift register. Put in the control signals, the green lines, the address lines, the white ones are data. Then we're going to be plugging in the row address lines from the CRTC for the lower address lines. And then we're just going to be making use of some 8 address lines from the CRTC there. We're plugging in the control signals for the shift register. The raster image comes out of the video RAM into the shift register. And then we're just going to load up the test program into the Nanocomp, run it. This is the random data that exists in the video character generator to start with. And if we now just load in the file we just created, you can now see the raster images of the characters loading. So we've got 256 characters repeated multiple times down the screen there. And if we look at the start and end, you can see it starts with a blank, and the end of the first line, it should be an O. It's not quite got all the characters there. So we'll look at the timing a bit, and we'll just set the default colors to white on blue. So now we've installed the character generator RAM, what we're going to do now is install the character RAM so that we can actually define each character individually rather than driving it from the address lines. So we're going to be adding a dual port RAM initially. This diagram has the larger 32K RAM that we'll be using later. What we're going to be doing is driving this from both the CPU address lines and the video controller address lines. And this is then going to define which character values from 0 to 255, driving the A4 to A11 address lines, where the lower address lines are being determined by the CRTC row address. So now we're going to add in the character RAM. This is going to drive the address lines for the character generator directly from the data lines coming out of here. We're then going to plug in the CRTC address lines into the character RAM here, and then the CPU lines are going to be just brought across from the other RAM there, and then we should be ready to test this. So this is the default test before we've loaded the character generator. Now we've loaded a test pattern here. Now we'll run another test program that shows the character set in its full. So this should give us a matrix. And we can see here we've got all 256 characters there, but we do have some timing issues we need to sort out at the beginning and the end of each line. So now what we need to do is just adjust some of the timing of the display, because we've got some gaps at the beginning of the lines, and also we've got sort of 2/3 of the character appearing at the beginning, and you can see we're missing some characters at the end here as well. So we're just going to adjust the timing, and we're also going to add a cursor to the display, which will be a 3-line cursor underneath the characters. So we've added a gate, an XOR gate, and 2 flip-flops so we can delay some signals, and we're going to combine the cursor signal with the output of the shift register and then drive the foreground background. We can see there that we've got the flashing cursor, but it's not quite lined up properly. So we're now going to change the delay on the shift register latch. So this is by default. This will be with 1 clock cycle delay, 2 clock cycles delay, 3 clock cycles delay, and when we get to 4 clock cycles, we should find it looks quite good, and you can see the cursor lines up as well quite nicely. In the previous step, we were using individual logic components, and what we're going to do in this video is we're going to replace these highlighted logic chips here with a single programmable logic device. So PLDs are programmable devices. We're using an Atmel ATF22V, and this allows us to define the logic for the input and output signals in a programmable way, which I'll be showing you in a few seconds. So we're going to be replacing these logic chips with the PLD. We define the rules that program the PLD and use the compiler to compile the definition that generates us an output file known as a JED file. This JED file we can then use to program the PLD. So now we're replacing the chips and wiring in the PLD to all the different lines. This should simplify things quite a bit. Now we're going to test it using our standard test program, and we can see now we've got the same display and the same characters we had before. So we've already got one RAM for the characters, but what we're going to do now is to add another RAM for the colours. But because these RAMs are larger and they're single port, we actually have to have some buffers so that when the CPU and the CRTC are accessing the RAM, then we have to arbitrate between the two lots of signals. The colour signal is also then going to go into a latch, which then drives the foreground and background colours for the foreground background multiplexer. So this determines whether we show the foreground or background colour based on the foreground background value coming out of our shift register here. Then we also need to add some bidirectional buffers so that when the CPU wants to update the video RAM for the characters and the colour, then it can select which one it wants to talk to. These are the video RAM chips we're using. They're very fast, 15 nanosecond access time, and although they're 28 pins, they're actually 0.3 of an inch pitch. They're quite long and skinny. So you're going to remove the dual port RAM. We're shifting the shift register up towards the top of the board there, and we're also going to move the color multiplexer for foreground background colors over to the left hand side to give us a bit more space. Checking things off there on the diagram. We're going to have the color video RAM towards the top there and the character video RAMs down the bottom, wiring in the various signals there for the bidirectional buffers and the color latch there. Then making sure we've got all the address signals there in green and wiring in our ribbon cables there for some of our CPU and CRTC values. The blue lines are the control signals, green are the address. So we're just going to test this with an updated test program, which now does colours. So if we load in the character generator RAM, we can see the details coming here. It's a little slower than before because we're waiting for the blanking period before updating each character, which means we don't get any interference on the display. So now we're going to tidy up the boards here. So we're moving some of the chips around to mean that the PLDs are all a bit closer together, make it a bit tidier. And then what we're also going to be doing is getting the Nanocomp monitor to initialize the video adapter and load the character generator RAM as well at the same time. This is simplifying things to remove some of the ribbon cables here to make things a bit more reliable. So that's the burning the ROM, and it now initializes on power up. So now we're going to simplify the design here, and that we're removing some of the logic chips and replacing the PLDs. We're also taking some of the ribbon cables out and replacing them with these hardwired ones. So these green lines have replaced ribbon cables, and now we're actually hooking in some of the address lines so we don't need to use the ribbon cables coming from the right hand side there. Checking that it still works, and we can now see this is the test pattern, but you did see some snow there when this was updating, and now this is a modified version that we'll be showing you, which now waits for the blanking period before updating the display. So it's a little slower, but there's no mess. So you can see here I've defined some custom characters suitable for using for Tetris, and we've used the last 16 block of characters to do this. So we've got the tetronymos and the blanks at the bottom. If you look at the last line here on row 18, you can see that the F0 all the way up to FC have got the custom characters. So what I did is downloaded this source code from GitHub. I created two folders, one with the original code and one with the modified code. And if you want to have a look at video 9 and video 10 of the video controller series, this has a detailed explanation of the changes made in the source code, and the WinMerge here shows the main changes. So the main.c, Tetris.c have the main game changes, and then this is where we're compiling using the CMOC C compiler, and this will generate an SREC output file, which then we can load directly down into the Nanocomp and run it. So this is the SREC file, and all I'm going to do now is to paste this file name into my download program and put the Nanocomp into load mode and load the program and see if we can run Tetris. So we'll press S. You'll see here we're on the lowest level here, so it's actually quite slow. What I will do is introduce, I'll make a change to allow me to show you what the highest level speed is. But you can see with the drop key, we can actually make it go reasonably fast. So what I've done now is I have reduced the gravity value for the first level to be the fastest that it gets to, just so we can see what this looks like. So I've reset the Nanocomp. I'm just going to run this updated version now. We'll press start. You should be able to see the sort of speed that this comes down, which is a bit faster than it certainly was before. Getting the stage where it get a bit more challenging to complete properly. As you can see, it becomes a little more difficult with the keypad to do as good of a job. So it can actually get to a reasonably challenging speed, certainly faster than probably I'm able to do using this keypad. And if we just make it finish, so that's it. So we've managed to show that the Tetris game can run on the Nanocomp, and by a bit of clever programming, we've been able to remove all of the screen refresh artifacts, all the snow effects and things like that. So I hope you found it interesting. If you found it useful, please hit like, and if you don't want to miss out on future videos, please hit subscribe. In the next videos, what I'm going to be doing is looking at upgrading the video card to be able to do 640 by 480 two color graphics. And what I hope to try and do is to perhaps try and do some sort of lunar lander type game, if I can find something suitable to convert to run on a Nanocomp. Thanks for watching.